Okay. I am trying to figure out why we have audio repeating and repeating and repeating. It shouldn't be. If I pull this up, where is that coming from? I'm sorry. I will be done here in a moment. There we go. Okay. Now we can continue with the program. Ready? Ready.
The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, it is. Yes, we made it to Friday. Now, I believe every Friday is a good one. But for some, today's a religious holiday. For others, it's a holiday because it's opening day for baseball. Spring has now officially sprung. Before we get on with the show, a quick programming note. Because so many people tune in for the Empty Wheel Friday shows but don't listen the rest of the week, let me take a moment to invite you to check out the show the other 4 days. I broadcast live weekdays from 5 to 6 Eastern, 2 to 3 Pacific. The audio stream is carried live on the Progressive Voices Network. You can get the free app, find them on TuneIn, or go to progressivevoices.com. You can also get it at nicolesandler.com. That's where the show is based. And aside from The Daily Show, there's enough content there to keep you busy for a long time, including archives of some of my music radio interviews from my Los Angeles radio days. Now, we also stream live video to YouTube, Facebook Live, Shitter, and Twitch, and the show goes out as a podcast when the live stream ends. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, and know that we are not behind any paywall. Just as Marcy operates at EmptyWheel.net, my work is available to watch, listen, and share. We run no advertising, but do depend on your support to continue doing the work. So if you appreciate it and can afford to support us with an occasional or ongoing monthly donation, we could sure use it and sincerely appreciate it. In addition to our regulars, Mondays, Jonathan Larson of The Fucking News. Thursdays with Howie Klein of DownWithTyranny.com and the Blue America Pack. And of course, the incredible Empty Wheel Fridays. We also feature great guests. In the last few weeks alone, we've had Barb McQuaid, Rachel Bitticoffer, Tom Schaller and Paul Waldman, Digby, Jason Leopold. You get the idea. So please do check us out on other days too, or go through the archives and listen at your pleasure. Okay. Now on to the main event. It's actually Thursday, but we're pretending it's Friday because Marcy is taking a long weekend, not as you would think for Easter, and I guess it's Good Friday, but I think every Friday is good. It's your birthday. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Yes, it's my birthday and a bunch of other things, so I'm going to go have a very fancy meal at a very fancy Irish estate tonight, and then wander around some Irish town that I haven't been in before.
Very nice. Well, we're here. Lots of people are taking the day off because it's Easter this weekend, but I don't celebrate. So we're here and giving you a lot of information to absorb over the weekend because, there's not going to be much going on. But a lot went on this week. What else is new? There's no such thing as a slow news day anymore. So Marcy Wheeler, I guess, I don't even know where to start. I guess we should start
with Ronna McDaniel.
Exactly. Ronna McDaniel, hired by NBC, fired quickly after pushback. When you heard the news, how shocked were you, or were you?
I mean, I'm not surprised they hired her. I'm shocked that at how tone deaf they are about it. I'm shocked at how many people don't understand that it's not just that she's a liar. Because cable news hires a lot of people who are liars. It's that they don't understand she is a key player in a criminal conspiracy to steal an election. It's like, how do you invite somebody? Like, what, are we going to invite Jack the Ripper now? Are we going to invite Jeffrey Epstein? Are we going to invite, it's just like, no, you don't invite somebody who had a key role in a criminal plot to steal the election to do anything on news except answer hard questions about their role in that criminal plot.
Right. So you have a piece up at EmptyWheel.net saying that the headline reads, NBC should have grilled Ronna McDaniel until she self-deported. Absolutely. I mean, they lost a great, well, Meet the Press is just sort of not helpful much these days. There were a lot of questions that they could have asked her and didn't. But my curiosity was, we got the news last Friday after we had taped the show that she had been hired, and the outrage, you know, continued all weekend. My question on the show on Monday, before Monday night, was whether or not Rachel Maddow was going to forcefully, strongly condemn the move. And she, I was surprised, frankly, at how intense her criticism was. I applaud her. What'd you think of her statement?
I didn't see hers. I saw Chuck Todd's.
Okay.
Which was Sunday, like, right?
Right. So, Sunday on Meet the Press.
On Meet the Press, like, Kristen Welker has a prearranged interview with Ronna, and then Ronna gets hired. So it looks like Meet the Press is inviting their paid contributors. And so immediately after that interview, which was a typical softball, mm-hmm. I mean, is it right to call January 6th, convicted January 6th felons hostages? And she was very careful about couching her response about violence on January 6th. And I'm like, the obvious follow-up is, should people who conspired to obstruct the vote certification, including those involved in the white collar obstruction of the vote certification, like you, Ronna, should they go to prison?
Right.
And should they go for 3 years prison time, like the people already prosecuted have? And of course, that was an ask. But then Chuck Todd weighed in. I, like I said, I didn't see Maddow's. One thing, though, I mean, only some people, I know that Chris Hayes did this too, but like, not even all the NBC people are getting the criminal aspect of this. They're
right.
Worried about the lying. But
yeah.
They're not getting the crime.
That she was complicit.
Like, don't invite rapists, don't
right.
invite murderers, don't invite people who try and steal elections.
Right.
Should be a basic rule.
And Rachel Maddow, what she did was her typically very long buildup. But what she showed a picture of four different people throughout history who were fascists, who tried to become president and become dictator, very similar to what Donald Trump is doing. But the difference was they were running on these fringe third party tickets that nobody ever heard of and that didn't go anywhere, mostly because of that. So these four people who she says live inside her head are relatively unknown to the general public because they sort of faded off into obscurity because they didn't have the backing of a major political party. We like it or not, we have a two-party system here. So what she does is pretty much lay the fault squarely at Ronna McDaniel as chair of the RNC for legitimizing his position and making him a Republican candidate with all the resources and support of the Republican Party behind him, which means he will not fade off into oblivion. And she made a pretty good case. And, I criticize her often, but I thought she was spot on with this one. So they reversed their decision. And now Ronna McDaniel is suing, which I guess is to be expected. They had a contract.
But it could get interesting. I mean, like, look, I mean, you know, the post that you mentioned, I wrote, I was like, don't fire her. Don't withdraw the offer. Instead, just grill her. Instead, just make her sit down and face up. And Washington Post had an article, I think, yesterday describing that, she knew she was going to go to some outlet. So now maybe no one else will do it either because of the backlash here. But she had pitched NBC on a presidential debate in 2020. Right. And based on that quote unquote goodwill, she sort of felt like she could go to NBC. And then the NBC brass talked her into including MSNBC on that.
And by offering her more money, sweetening the deal, right?
By offering her more money. And I think the subtext of the Washington Post article is also by reassuring her that she wouldn't get slammed by MSNBC hosts.
Right.
And it's like, did you really say that you were going to pull punches on a criminal because you thought that she would bring something to the network. And I mean, what it reveals, honestly, because I think Oliver Darcy said that there was there was a bidding war for her that we didn't know about. Right. Wow. So again, we'll see whether some other network wants to pick her up. But, you know, and all these Fox News pundits are like, oh, how dare you? How dare you refuse diverse viewpoints? I'm like,
Fox. Hello.
Like, Fox is saying that. I mean, like Jessica Tarloff and Jessica Tarloff is the only one you have. And, you know, like, she's superb, but she's so low down the pecking order of Democratic strategists that, it's just, you know, it's a testament to the fact that D.C. really hasn't accounted for the fact, D.C. and New York mm-hmm. have not accounted for the fact that this was a crime, right? It's all become so normalized that... and Judd Legum had a piece out today. He had been tracking this early after 2021, and he's got a piece since 2021 of the money that corporations like the Koch brothers, like AT&T, have invested with election deniers. And, you know, maybe this disaster on the part of NBC will wake people up to the fact that we can't normalize this. You know, we have to start calling out the people who are normalizing it, because this is a crime. We can't just say, oh, it's cool. I mean, and in the post that you mentioned, I cited reporting from December, new reporting from December in the Detroit News of a conversation Ronna McDaniel had in November 2020 with Donald Trump and with the canvassers who were trying to just discount the votes of Wayne County of Detroit. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she's very, very complicit. As I described, like the investigation in Michigan into fake electors is still ongoing. The investigation, Jack Smith, as far as we know, he's still investigating. She's at that sweet spot between those two investigations. And the notion, like even from a vetting perspective, the notion that you would hire someone like that if you're NBC, with the risk that she could be indicted by either of those investigations anytime soon. And Ronna, like, she was involved in some of the other states, but obviously she's from Michigan and she's very, very close with one of the key fake electors in Michigan. Like, Ronna's career has relied on Kathy Burden, and Burden was one of the two top fake electors in Michigan. So, you know, it's just a testament. I can't tell you, you know, like I say this a lot. I'm cautiously optimistic about November, but If we don't make it, we will not make it because the New York Times is so shitty, because NBC is so shitty, because journalists are not stepping up to the plate of the threat that we face right now.
No,
because the corporations are too chicken to say this was a crime.
Right. And if you listen to Chuck Todd's criticism on Sunday, you know, he's like, well, this is about access. But that doesn't make any sense, because Ronna McDaniel is shunned by the party. Trump hates her, and she's been replaced, obviously. It's like, this will not gain them access, having her on staff. If anything, it might piss them off even more. And Trump has been, you know, new nickname for her now. It's just, so what happens to her now? I think she has a big payday because she's suing and she wants to be paid for the whole contract.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, she may get $600,000 out of doing nothing, which, again, NBC should have made her quit to avoid being actually questioned, you know, hard questions.
Right. And that Washington Post article yesterday was pretty devastating. I mean, the fact that they had to convince her to go on MSNBC and they sweetened the deal and they made promises. That's not news. That's not a news organization. That's how a PR firm operates.
Yeah. And I want to say Morning Joe had a different take. They're like, you know, if you want a viewpoint, get a Republican. This is not Republican. This is something else. You know, like, get somebody who will tell you what Republicans actually think. So, and meanwhile, the Republican Party is using election denying as a litmus test for hiring under Lara Trump.
They're now asking potential employees, do you believe that the 2020 election was stolen?
And obviously, you know, that's not about reality. That's about, are you willing to suspend reality in service of Donald Trump?
Yeah.
And it's going to be interesting because, like, if they actually are hiring people who don't know what really happened, who are so divorced from reality that they can't read polls, that they won't be able to respond to polls, it actually may really hurt them. I mean, in the same way that refusing to take mail-in ballots hurt them in 2020, and there's some indication they may be doing the same here, you know, great, cut your own throat. Like, if you feel the need to be, and now we can segue to John Eastman.
Yes.
Speaking of people.
Yeah. So this is the post you put up just this morning. Worse than Segretti, judge recommends John Eastman be disbarred. John Eastman, of course, as far as I can tell, was basically the architect of the fake elector scheme, right?
Both him and Chesbro.
Okay.
Who we like to call Cheesebro. Ken
Cheesebro
is the one who first did the math on here's what happens on January 6th. And then John Eastman, the opinion recommending him to be disbarred starts in his involvement in Texas's challenge. There was a lawsuit in Texas and a lawsuit in Georgia that he got involved with, and his argument that Trump should be able to get involved in the Texas lawsuit that was decided by the Supreme Court. So there's all these propagandists who are like, poor John Eastman, he just had a fringe theory. I'm like, it was a fringe theory rejected by the Supreme Court. It was a fringe theory rejected by three of Trump's appointees. I guess Clarence Thomas would have reviewed it, but he's not even a Trump appointee. Like, the two worst, the two worst Trumpists aren't even Trump appointees. So it's not that it's a fringe theory. It's that it's not a legal theory. And the opinion, which is like 120 pages, 128 pages, goes through one by one, the lies he told, the way, you know, like, there's this fascinating through line of it where it describes in a series of footnotes, here's the guy that John Eastman claimed to be relying on, and here's what actual experts said. And so you can see how election denialism happened, right? So it's they found some guy who claimed to be a statistician who basically had an undergraduate degree. And as soon as a real statistician looked at what he was saying, it was like this, you know, like there's this extended discussion in there about whether it was reasonable to believe that the chances Joe Biden got the votes he got are one in a quadrillion, right? And they're like, no. So the opinion makes for interesting reading, but it's, you know, it's there's a long discussion about whether John Eastman had a First Amendment right to lie about all this stuff, because some of the moral turpitude judgments are about public lies he told. Like, he went on Steve Bannon and told some lies, and they're like, no, you don't, because you're a lawyer and your claims have additional weight if you're a lawyer. And you were saying things, one thing to Steve Bannon, or one thing in something you published for Claremont University after the fact, and another thing that you said to Mike Pence on January 4th. You know, and you can't deny that you said these things. So that's interesting reading. It's a recommendation. It goes to, I guess, the Supreme Court in California. He claims he's going to appeal, has to appeal because he can't afford a lawyer in Georgia, much less, let's see what happens in D.C. You know, I'm like, get a job at McDonald's, guy, or
drive an Uber,
get a public defender. And meanwhile, Jeffrey Clark's disbarment is finally going forward in D.C. And that was happening. It was kind of a split screen, Jeffrey Clark and John Eastman. And, you know, I sort of had this moment where I was like, all these corrupt white old lawyers look the same to me. You know, they're all kind of people were confusing one and the other. But like, Jeffrey Clark was interesting because as he was on the stand invoking the Fifth Amendment. And he actually invoked attorney-client privilege, and the D.C. bar is like, well, who's your client? And he said, before his lawyer could tell him to shut up, he said, oh, Donald Trump is my lawyer. And that was under oath on the stand.
His lawyer?
And that's a really damning claim, because it suggests that Donald Trump was converting the legal services that taxpayers pay for to try and steal an election. So, I think it was bad move on his part. And that's going to continue on I'm not sure whether it continues on that today or next week, but anyway, you know, he's calling his witnesses. The bar has finished their case, but it's going to be the same kind of thing where Clark calls these people who have an undergraduate stats degree, and then the bar calls people who are actually experts. And says,
right.
Here's
yeah, but here's the thing about Jeffrey Clark. This was Trump's final acting attorney general in the last days of his, you know, administration. And his name has been floated as a potential attorney general should Trump get back in. So here's the question. If he's disbarred, can he still be attorney general? And the answer is yes.
Yeah. The only thing that would require him to be barred really is the solicitor general position.
Wow. It's just crazy. So, okay, all that's going on. Meanwhile, the week began on Monday, March 25th, which was the date originally designated to start the hush money trial in New York. Of course, that got delayed because of what we talked about last week, the SDNY being late and turning over documents. So they delayed it. They set the date on Monday, trial date, April 15th. Good day. Depending how you look at it.
This is what you get for when you pay taxes in New York.
That's right.
Thank you, New York State, for doing this. Actually, it's New York City. But anyway, yeah. And the judge was quite pissed. The judge was like, you know, you guys really are just engaged in bullshit. I mean, he didn't say bullshit, but he was just like, this was just a stunt to delay. And I was sort of, as this was happening, I was sort of saying, you know, at this point, journalists have to stop treating these claims of discovery problems seriously, because Trump's lawyers have tried them in every single one of his cases, and they've failed every single time. And this was, you know, this was a case where Trump didn't even subpoena stuff until this month, until March. And the judge was like, you know, there's nothing much here, you know, that you can't. And so now he does that. Trump starts attacking Judge Merchant's daughter, who yep. has some tie to the Democratic Party. And Merchant already has an opinion saying this is not an ethical problem. Now, what's interesting is Trump was actually attacking what he claimed to be Merchant's daughter off of a Twitter account or a social media account that's not hers.
Right. It was hacked or something, right?
So she went private before this all started, and somebody picked up or recreated her account.
Right.
And loaded it up with statements that are not her. And it's interesting because something very similar happened to Engoron's wife.
Huh.
You recall that Trump was saying Engoron's wife was saying certain things on social media, and that turned out not to be the wife's account. It turned out to be somebody who had the same name, but not the wife's account. And I'm like, this feels like identity theft to support Donald Trump's attacks on family members of judges. So it's sort of interesting.
It's very interesting. So the judge issued a gag order, a limited gag order.
Right. Three gag orders now.
Right. So you can't talk about family members. He could still talk about Trump. He could still talk about, you know, he could still call the whole process a hoax or whatever he wants, but he can't attack family members like the daughter. Well, the next day he went out and just did it again. So I guess the law does not apply to him, or he thinks any other person who went and did exactly what the gag prohibited him to do would have had some kind of consequences, whether it be jail time or a fine or something. Is anything going to happen? Is anything enforceable?
It's enforceable. I mean, when Trump violated Judge Engoron's gag, the judge started fining him, and that's what could happen here. The standards are a little bit different for New York City than they are for New York State. So we'll see what happens. But
Okay. Now, separately on Monday, there was another hearing, or there had been the result of Trump's appeal of the amount of the bond that he was required to post should he want to appeal the decision in the New York for the Alvin Bragg case, right? I get them all confused. Tish James case.
Right. In the Tish James case, the bond went from $450 million to
175.
Still a lot. Yeah. Twice what he had to bond for E. Jean Carroll.
Right.
And
they extended the deadline. Instead of having it due on Monday, he gets 10 days. Was there any reason given for this?
No. You know, most people are outraged by it, and I get that. But I did have somebody who knows New York City, New York state law very well say one reason you might do that is because if you've already placed the bond, the $450 million bond, then you have permanent injury while you're making an appeal. And, you know, one of the most important things is that Trump is still allowed to get loans in New York, which he hadn't been on the prior order. So, you know, we'll see what happens in now 3 days, 4 days over Easter weekend. Trump still has Barbara Jones as a monitor. So he still has a judge basically in his business rear end, right, making sure he doesn't play any funny business. But at the same time, the SPAC associated with True Social went public and instantly made Trump a billionaire.
Yes.
But he can't cash out. So he's in this weird situation where he's got a lifeline because True Social went public. It's going to crash, of course. It's going to, you know, like it's like his own little Silicon Valley crash waiting to happen. And it won't be him. I mean, he'll get hurt because he won't be, he's a seven billionaire today. He'll be a three billionaire tomorrow and a 900 millionaire the day after. But it's going to be his cultists who get really hurt.
Sure.
They're going to invest all their life savings. And
So he's got a hedge. He's got another way to generate money. He's selling Bibles.
Bibles, yeah.
You just can't make this stuff up. So, all right. So all that's going on. There was another hearing this week, this one in L.A., Hunter Biden. I know your favorite topic to cover. Wednesday, he was trying to get the tax case dismissed because is it politically motivated? What happened there?
There's not a transcript yet, so I'm relying on the reporting of others. But I did not expect Judge Scarcy to be very sympathetic to these views. Judge Scarcy is a Trump appointee, but also from the start was like, okay, we're going to trial at 9 a.m. on January 23rd. Nothing's going to hold it up. You know, that presumes that this thing was going. I've been told that he's a really harsh sentencer for tax cases. I mean, it was a bad draw for Hunter Biden. What I have heard of yesterday's hearing leads me to believe that Judge Scarcy misunderstands at least one thing about the diversion agreement in Delaware. But also that I had written a post, I don't know, at some point, about how Judge Scarcy had ordered briefing on two interesting legal points. One was, if Hunter Biden signs a contract with the U.S. Attorney for Delaware, is that contract still good after David Weiss, the U.S. Attorney for Delaware, after David Weiss becomes special counsel? And then the other one was, if Leo Weiss, who's one of the AUSAs, if Leo Weiss said in Delaware that Hunter Biden was a resident of D.C. in 2018, can he then claim in the tax case that he was a resident of Los Angeles in the same year, in 2018? And David Weiss really didn't answer either of those questions, which I think are really interesting legal questions, because I think that David Weiss is playing fast and loose with these legal appointments. Mm-hmm. But I think, and I think unsurprisingly, Scarcy's going to say it's not up to him to decide venue. The jury needs to decide venue. So he may, for example, restrict the AUSAs from being able to argue that venue question. And these are just for the misdemeanor counts. So it's actually, you know, like it's not the big deal. The big deal are the three felony counts. But so I'm not surprised that Judge Scarcy was not all that sympathetic to Hunter Biden. It's just, you know, as I was thinking about it, it is absolutely clear to me that this thing was politicized from day one.
Oh, of course.
What is also clear, though, is that our legal precedents don't fit Hunter Biden. So, for example, Abby Lowell, Hunter's super lawyer, was like, you know, Hunter suffered a grave due process injury when these IRS agents went out and did this whole, you know, this whole political campaign about his using his private records. This is a crime. They engaged in a crime to make him make sure that he was charged more heavily. He ended up being charged more heavily. And so Abby Lowell filed to dismiss the indictment on that basis. And prosecutors, I mean, prosecutors are full of shit on a lot of points, but on this one, I think that they're not. Prosecutors are like, that precedent that you're trying to apply here only applies if the prosecutors themselves engaged in misconduct. And we didn't engage in misconduct. It was the IRS agents who may have, right? Uh-huh. They're not even ceding that point. And therefore, the indictment itself is not faulty. You know, the whole Hunter Biden case is full of stuff like that. And unfortunately, most reporters aren't going to report that. Most reporters aren't going to say, you know, one of the interesting things, and I think this was in CNN's report, is Alexander Smirnoff's attorney attended yesterday's hearing. Hunter Biden did not, but Alexander Smirnoff's attorney did. And Smirnoff's attorney did, you know, like I think the case against Smirnoff is shittier than people make out to be too.
Oh, really?
Partly, huh? Yeah. Partly because the evidence doesn't yet show that he was working on Russian disinformation. For all we know, he was working on Trump disinformation. He has some tie to Rudy Giuliani or something, and that's what led him to lie. But there are some weaknesses to that case. And so Smirnoff's attorney shows up and he's basically like, I want to find out how these prosecutors are going to deal with the fact that you chased my client as a witness and then decided to charge him. Right. And if both of these, you know, if all these lawyers could get together and compare notes, you might see a case made about the Scott Brady side channel. The problem is that that David Weiss should not be in charge of this investigation. It is an egregious ethical problem for him to be overseeing this investigation because he's a witness in it. Like right. He's a witness to the orders that Bill Barr gave him, to the communications he had with Scott Brady. Scott Brady did not claim to have vetted this, did not vet it. So he is a witness to that. He has no business conducting an investigation into this stuff. And yet there he is.
There's no doubt that it's politically motivated. I mean, it just has written all over it. The only reason they're going after him is because they got nothing on Joe Biden. So on it goes. You've written about Lev Parnas a lot. We talked about him last week. He tweeted out a video that they don't want you to see. What did it say?
So Lev is showing receipts. He's posting serially. The most interesting one, which he posted a couple weeks ago, I think, was the postcard that Rudy Giuliani sent him while he was in prison in EDVA or jail in EDVA awaiting arraignment. And Rudy was like, oh, so sorry you got arrested. We couldn't go to Vienna. What a bummer. You know, Manafort only got 7 years, so you won't be too bad in Manafort's lawyer's hands. And it was really a shocking postcard. So Lev is serially, like he tweeted out texts he had with a guy named Derek Harvey, who was then a Devin Nunes aide on HPSI, showing that Devin Nunes was involved in this information operation. And then the one that you're talking about is an interview that Rudy and Lev did with Viktor Shokin, the corrupt prosecutor, the corrupt Ukrainian prosecutor. I'm guessing that interview was January or February 2019, if I remember correctly. Shokin had tried to travel to the United States and was denied a visa, which is where he started blaming Marie Yovanovitch. Mm-hmm. And so instead of doing an in-person meeting, they did it on Zoom. I caution people about taking what Lev Parnas says unquestioningly.
Right.
And I do that, like this particular video is interesting because it shows Rudy saying, was there a bribe involved? And Shokin saying no. But then Parnas cut it off. Like, you don't see what Shokin said next. Uh-huh. And so that, you know, that leads me to wonder, did you cut it off before Shokin said something really damning? Or, you know, like, we shouldn't listen to Shokin in any case. But, you know, he's like, this is a smoking gun because Shokin said there was no bribe. I'm like, you know, show us the entire video. Right. Don't cut it off before that. I mean, the other thing is, and I made a post about this, I forgot whether it was this year, this week or last week, is in his congressional testimony, Parnas said that he had been smeared with the firing of Marie Yovanovitch. And he, you know, he sort of suggested he was involved, then immediately turned and reminded that Pete Sessions was part of his information operation. I'm like, if you're going to blame Pete Sessions, you can't disclaim your involvement in the Marie Yovanovitch thing, because that's the whole point about the Pete Sessions thing, is you donated a bunch of money to him and he wrote a letter to get Marie Yovanovitch fired. And in his book, he's, you know, his book is, and I'm still reading his book, it's interesting. You know, all memoirs are interesting for what people leave out. And one of the things that Lev leaves out is he describes being at this 2018 meeting where he tells Trump that Marie Yovanovitch is no good. And Trump immediately says, fire her. And then says, I did not know, this is in the book, he says, I did not know that Igor Fruman was taping me. So that was caught on tape. And, you know, I'm sort of like, some of this book is him trying to pitch the stuff that was caught on tape in the best way possible. That was caught on tape, his explanations, like, yeah. But he says, the people I hang out with in Ukraine thought that Yovanovitch was no good. And I'm like, let's talk about the people you hang out with in Ukraine, because sometimes you describe them and they're mobbed up. And one of the things that SDMY investigated is whether you were doing the business of that mobbed up person rather than just Yuri Lutsenko when you got her fired. So I take the things that Lev Parnas says with a grain of salt.
Gotcha.
They're still, you know, but because the other thing is, this book doesn't hide the fact that he was mobbed up and had ties to Russian, you know, like, he's trying to implicate Trump and Rudy in his own dodgy ties, but he's trying to do so in a way that doesn't fully admit to his own dodgy ties and ties that precede Rudy, right? And go beyond Rudy. And so I'm a little bit skeptical of things that come out of Lev Parnas, but I like to see the receipts because they're quite interesting.
There you go. All right. So that's what that is. A topic we haven't really talked about since you've been coming on every Friday is Julian Assange. But is there movement in the extradition case, or what's happening with him?
So the high court considered a bunch of, he wanted, the way in which it works is, prosecutors get their judgment, high court approves, home secretary approves, and then Julian Assange, after that approval, gets to say, but I didn't get to make my own appeal. Here are the things I'd like to appeal on my own. And he had a hearing to see whether he'd be allowed to appeal any of those. And the high court came back and said, you can appeal on three bases, but first we're going to give the U.S. opportunity to give us a reassurance.
This is the British high court.
One of those is totally basic. One is death penalty. Julian Assange was never going to be subject to the death penalty in the United States. And they sort of say that. The opinion was like, you know, you're supposed to be sent to Australia. You are, part of the assurances are already that you get sent to Australia for your punishment, any punishment. So you're not going to be, you know, you're not going to suffer the death penalty. So that assurance is going to be really easy. The assurance that Julian Assange will be able to make the same First Amendment arguments as an American will be reasonably easy, mostly because people on espionage cases don't get to make First Amendment arguments. Trump isn't going to be able to make a First Amendment argument. You know, Chelsea Manning wasn't able to make a First Amendment argument, so he won't either. Where it will get interesting is, and the high court says this only matters for three charges. In the United States, in Europe, Article 10, which is what this is talking about, is a balancing act, right? Because Europe has privacy. And so in Europe, if something is of public interest, you can publish it, but also people have privacy rights. And if something implicates both of those, there's a balancing act that goes on. And the way in which Judge Baritzer, the judge who first approved his extradition, the way in which she got there is to say, sure, a lot of this is public interest, but mass publishing the names of U.S. and coalition sources without any redactions is not in the public interest, and all those people have privacy interests. And so was the public interest of these filings more than the privacy interests of these people? No. And therefore, she got to the Article 10 standard that way. But there's no privacy in the United States. Like, you can publish whatever you want in the United States, barring defamation or barring or Privacy Act violations, which wouldn't cover him because he's not the government. And so it puts him in a really interesting place in the United States because there's no prior restraint, you know, So it's actually interesting in sort of a good way, because, you know, I think Julian Assange is a liar and a creep. But even though I relied on some of these same filings that he's been charged for, but I also think that extraditing him under the charges as written is dangerous for journalism and for the First Amendment in general. And what he's saying is, I want to be able to get there and make an argument that the Pentagon Papers precedent about prior restraint means I can't be charged for these three crimes. Now, one of the things that DOJ could do, which would be sort of interesting, is say, we'll drop those three charges. And that would shut up all of the journalists to a large degree, because that would say, you know, that would remove the thing that the journalists claim to be most concerned about. Mm-hmm. But, you know, most of the people talking about Julian Assange haven't read the indictment. Most of them are working off of a 2019 indictment, when the 2020 indictment like lays out that this entire time he was also a hacker, and he was, you know, like the hacking charges involving Chelsea Manning are just a small part of the hacking indictment, the hacking charge against him. Anyway, so one of the other things that they could do with these charges, depending on what kind of evidence they want to share, is before Julian Assange published them, he gave a chunk of them to a guy named Israel Shamir, who is spoken of as if he is. I mean, first of all, he's a Holocaust denier, but second of all, he's spoken of as if he's some kind of Russian asset. And Shamir shared those cables before Julian Assange published any of them with Belarus. And so Lukashenko was able to get advance notice of basically the dissidents identified in those cables and start cracking down on them before the U.S. knew that they would be identified. It's similar to something that Julian Assange may have done with the Vault 7, the CIA hacking tools. And it's something that gets to his relationship with Russia, that he has at different times over the course since 2010, maybe 2009, which is when his relationship with Israel Shamir started. He has given Russia advance notice, not published things that were detrimental to Russia. He has done for Russia what the heck, the National Enquirer, is that the one that worked with Donald Trump, the catch and kill?
Yeah.
It's the same relationship that Assange had done for Russia, what National Enquirer had done for Donald Trump. Wow. And that really gets to Assange's long-term relationship with Russia. And when you talk to WikiLeaks groupies about it and you say, you know, he could be found guilty on the cables publication charge just for having disseminated them unredacted to Israel Shamir. That they could prove that case just on that alone. And are you comfortable with the fact that he gave Lukashenko advance notice of dissidents? And they just, you know, they're not ready to respond to that. But that is a key aspect of who Julian Assange was. It's not publicly known, though. And so that's, but, you know, well, it'll be interesting. So DOJ has until April sometime April 15th, to provide those reassurances. And then there's another round of briefing and a hearing in May, and then the High Court will make these decisions. Now, it looks like the High Court really is just asking the U.S. to give them some kind of, you know, just to address this, because they believe that this isn't really a problem. So it looks like the High Court will eventually approve the extradition based on this, and then Julian Assange can appeal to the European Court. But maybe he'll get whisked away. So it's going to, you know, Julian Assange, Donald Trump, both managing to delay these things. So
what else is new? So one quick question. You said that we don't have privacy rights here. And I know in many cases we don't. But don't we have laws against doxing? I mean, isn't that if he's really.
No, we don't.
We don't. No. Wow. Doxing.
No, I mean, you have laws like Twitter can't release your DMs. They have to. I mean, I would caution people against believing Twitter follows the law anyway.
Right.
But so Twitter and the government, like the IRS, disgruntled IRS agents may have broken the law in sharing Hunter Biden's private IRS information. Right. That's because they're government agents. That's because there's a specific law prohibiting people from releasing IRS documents and another specific law prohibiting people from releasing grand jury materials. And that is the claim that, that Hunter Biden has against them. But, you know, if I look you up and find your criminal record, I saw somebody on Twitter, Garrett Ziegler, was going after a DUI she had in 2011 as a way to shut her up. It's a public record, I guess. And so they found this and they're using it to try and get her to shut up. And she's like, you know, this is already, you guys have already figured it out, but it includes her name and it includes a DUI from, you know, 15, 20 years ago, whatever, 14, 13 years ago. But, that's public. And it's because of their official records, you know, she can't then say that they, defamed her because right. It's a public record. So no, I mean, there's not that many protections for that.
So, but when we go back, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. So, I mean, if a State Department employee leaked those files intending to expose the identities of informants, then you would have a complaint against the State Department. This is again, similar to the lawsuit that Hunter Biden is taking against the IRS, but, no, against Julian Assange. No.
Gotcha. No, so going back to Trump for a second, keeping the privacy laws or lack thereof here in the U.S., part of the thing is the identity of the jurors. Are there specific instructions, or we're not there yet because the trials haven't begun? But there's concern that Trump would go after the jurors. He did grand jurors. Is there anything that protects them?
Yeah. In the E. Jean Carroll case, the jurors, their identities remained secret from Trump.
Oh.
In the New York City has a different law on grand juror secrecy. So Trump will get to know their identities. There I think already is a protective order on those identities. So when Trump starts leaking them, then you know, they can go after him or his lawyers. Again, in Florida, he's trying to release the identities of some witnesses. Uh-huh. Same thing, you know. No, I mean, Trump has made doxing people a key part of his terror campaigns against people who work against him.
Insane. It's just insane.
I mean, you know, one of the things, because I had to review the Roger Stone trial, in that case, the names of the jurors became public through some means we don't know, probably through a leak from one of the attorneys, not the prosecutors. And then people like Michael Chernovich and Jack Posobiec did that research for Roger Stone. And that's when you had one of the, in fact, the foreperson being like accused of being a partisan hack and blah, blah, blah. And so there is real precedent for just exactly that happening. And no one was ever disciplined for the leak of those jurors' names.
Wow. Wow. Okay. So Marcy Wheeler, I save the last one for the Supreme Court. Supreme Court on Tuesday heard the case of the mifepristone, the abortion pill case. Again, a judge in Florida ruled that the drug for medical abortion, that it shouldn't have gotten FDA approval 20 years ago, which it didn't. It's been used safely since. So they had a hearing again, Supreme Court. We can listen to the audio arguments. I know you did. So what do you make of what happened on Tuesday?
Was it a Florida or was it a Texas?
It was Texas. Did I say Florida? I'm in Texas. Yes. Yeah. Florida on the brain.
Because we haven't beat up on Florida yet today.
No.
Yeah, it's one of these judges that kind of they mainstream things through. You know, only Alito and Thomas were really seemed amenable to those arguments. Everyone else was, you know, first of all, the Solicitor General Elizabeth Perlegar is great. And yes. So, you know, everyone was like, oh my God, this woman is so masterful at what she's doing. But even I'm forgetting whether it was Sotomayor or whether it was KBJ Jackson. I think it was Jackson, but you know, saying somebody says, you know, did the FDA check these drugs sufficiently? And one of the women justices is like, but do judges have any expertise on pharmaceuticals?
Yes,
no, of course not. So why are we letting a judge to, you know, override the ruling of the FDA? So it's likely that that ruling is going to be overturned. Interestingly, the Supreme Court kicked back Texas's effort to enforce its own immigration law to the Fifth Circuit, and the Fifth Circuit sort of did what they should have done the first time. And the law allowing Texas to kick out migrants themselves went into effect for a couple of hours, and then the Fifth Circuit put a hold on it, which is what they should have done from the start. And you know, there's a bit of sanity coming through. And then a couple of weeks ago, Justice Roberts pushed a rule through the courts to say you can no longer go to this one judge in Texas to mainstream these arguments you want to make. Wow. So, you know, I think on the abortion drug, it's an FDA question, it's a regulation question, but it's also, you know, we're getting to a point. I mean, we didn't talk, there was a special election in Alabama.
Yes.
And a woman who lost handily in 2022 ran on both the IVF decision and also her own experience with abortion. And she won by a landslide, right?
Yes.
So this is a Trump plus one district, and she won by huge margins. And, you know, it's yet another testament that at least in special elections, choice is going to dictate the outcome of those elections. We'll see whether that translates into the general in November. But, you know, people just aren't accounting for that in polling. Like the polling on this showed that the Republican was going to win.
Ah.
Like this was a shock win. I mean, there was, I want to say Greg Sargent did an interview with her. So he looks really smart because he was like, you know, oh, I just did this interview and now she won by a landslide. But she handled choice aggressively and she won. And so I think, does that mean we're going to get rid of the Comstock Act? This is where we're going, right? Mm-hmm. Like everyone in DC is saying, because Clarence Thomas wants to take away our birth control, we need to reverse the Comstock Act. We need to codify not just abortions, the right to an abortion nationally, which is going to take more doing, but also the right to birth control. And it's going to be an interesting debate because Republicans, you know, go back to the notion that Republicans are being asked whether they believe the election was fair in 2020. These people are nutcases, but because they're nutcases, they're also not going to deviate from Republican ideology on choice. And that is going to prevent them from trying to negotiate a very difficult Republican position the Republicans are in because that they got put in
mm-hmm.
By Dobbs.
Right. But they're doubling down on it. It seems
right.
Like, right.
And a sane Republican Party would say, holy shit, we fucked up. We've got to reverse the position we've had on abortion or find some better position. You know, Trump is going to endorse a 16-week nationwide ban.
That's right.
Even though the Supreme Court said it should go to the states, meaning, you know, places like Michigan where it's constitutional now, they shouldn't be able to override that. So because the Republican Party is insane, they are not doing what they should do in the wake of the Dobbs counterreaction. And so, you know, that means you're going to see elections like you did in Alabama, where it is the deciding factor in the election.
Right. Just to refresh our memories, the Comstock Act basically says you can't send abortion medication through the mail. It's wider than that, but that's one of the things you can't send through the mail. So you think that would be overturned?
Well, that's what people are talking about. I think Tina Smith, actually, Minnesota senator, right? Mm-hmm. Is on the lead of this. But choice groups and Democrats in the Senate are talking about focusing on Comstock Act because it's so basic, like to tell anybody in this country that they can't have access to birth control.
Right.
But then also, Republicans, like the IVF decision in Alabama was crazy, and Republicans are, you know, in this difficult position because it's anti-life, you mm-hmm. know, it's clearly anti-life. And there are so many couples who rely on IVF to have families. Right. And so now Republicans are saying you can't have families because of my pro-family position.
Right. Of course.
It's an insane Republican Party. And that's one of the things that I think may save democracy.
Right. Now, this morning, I'm seeing it popping up in my feed everywhere. Many in the legal community, I guess, are now saying Sotomayor should step down so we don't get Ruth Bader Ginsburged again.
Whatever. I mean, I'd give it a month and see how Biden is doing. Like, yeah. I think Sotomayor, one of the opinions that I had in my life that was dead wrong was that Sotomayor wasn't an excellent choice to be Supreme Court. People were like, well, she's great on these issues, but I don't know whether she's going to be a like strong justice. And I think she's an amazing, she doesn't put up with this shit. And I do think she is trying to make an effort to cut the hostility on the court.
I think they all are.
Well, mostly her and Amy Coney Barrett are kind of going out and saying, let's try and cut the hostility. I think she's great. And I am really hesitant to have, as it was with with Ruth Bader Ginsburg, a bunch of people telling a woman who's reached the pinnacle of a career that, you know, they can tell her when she's got to step down.
Right.
I mean, there were mitigating circumstances with her. I think they're doing this with Sotomayor based off really old health data, like diabetes data from years ago.
Oh.
And so I get it. Right.
Yeah.
But honestly, if Democrats lose in November, it's sort of moot. It really is. Because if Donald Trump has another presidency, whether Sotomayor is on the court or not is just doesn't matter.
We're done anyway. This experiment in democracy, if you want to call that, is pretty much toast if Donald Trump somehow gets back into office. And again, my take on it is he won't win legitimately. He didn't last time. But they will do everything they can to, lie, cheat, and steal their way in, all the while saying the Democrats are stealing the election. This is the reality that we live in now.
Trump adopted Stop the Steal in conjunction with his New York case.
Yeah.
Oh. So making it a third election. Because remember, that came from Roger Stone in 2016.
Yes. Yep.
In a campaign. But did people forget this? Roger Stone was putting poll watchers outside of largely minority polling areas in swing states in 2016. He was enjoined from doing that, and then won on appeal in all the swing states. So not only would he do it again, but that precedent is there on the books in all these swing states already. And that strategy was a strategy that happened to coincide with what Russia was doing at the time.
Wow.
So here we are again, Donald Trump trying to use political violence to win the election.
Yep. Again, I'll refer everyone to a song by the Propellerheads featuring Shirley Bassey called History Repeating. go listen. I can't play it. I'll get copyright violated. But I would. I'd end with that. Marcy Wheeler, we're at the end of the hour. Anything I left out?
No, I'm sure there'll be a bunch by the time this actually plays tomorrow, but...
You're enjoying your birthday.
I'm going to be in the country. I'm going to be in the Irish countryside.
Yay. Well, you enjoy. Have a wonderful birthday. And we'll pick up next Friday. Marcy Wheeler from find her at emptywheel.net and support her work. She graciously is not behind any paywall. So show her that you appreciate the work she's doing over there and wish her a happy birthday, too. Thank you, Marcy Wheeler.
All right. Have a great weekend. Happy Easter, everyone.
And that's a wrap. Have a great weekend, everyone. I'll see you Monday. I'm Nicole Sandler. Thanks for listening. Peace out.
The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, it is. Yes, we made it to Friday. Now, I believe every Friday is a good one. But for some, today's a religious holiday. For others, it's a holiday because it's opening day for baseball. Spring has now officially sprung. Before we get on with the show, a quick programming note. Because so many people tune in for the Empty Wheel Friday shows but don't listen the rest of the week, let me take a moment to invite you to check out the show the other 4 days. I broadcast live weekdays from 5 to 6 Eastern, 2 to 3 Pacific. The audio stream is carried live